interesting fact, rather a truth that I discovered yesterday, even though I just listening to one sermon, that God does not have grandkids. God does not have grandchildren. Praise God. God, in other words, even if maybe your spiritual mother, your spiritual father is saying this person, or this person is the one that brought you up in the, you know, in the way of the Lord, or you are not a grandchild to God. Praise God. You are a son. Praise God. And to ladies, when I say a son, I'm also including you. Praise God. Because your spirit does not have a gender. Praise God. So I want you to know and have it on your, on the conscience, you know, on the surface of your mind that you discussed about that God is your father. It doesn't matter who led you to cry. It doesn't matter, you know, how young you are, whether you got born again today, or you are a son of God. Praise the Lord. You don't become a son after maturing, you know, after coming to church for a very long time, then I become a son of God. No. You are a son. Praise God. Whether you feel like it or you don't, you are a son of God. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Tell someone that God does not have grandchildren. Praise God. Hallelujah. And I want me to share with you today is going to help you. Like how I say, it might not sound very much like something that you want to hear today, but it's something that you need. Praise the Lord. It may not excite you. It may not be like, oh, wow. You know, but it will help you. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Today I want to talk about growth. Praise the Lord. Growing, right? You know, if they told me what I know now, 10 years ago, I would have told them that I want to grow up. But I told them, you know what, please, just let me go to primary school for the rest of my life because I don't think I can deal with growing up. Because it comes with a lot of responsibilities, right? Pray God, who can agree with me that adulting comes with a lot of responsibilities, right? All of a sudden, they expect you to act a certain way. All of a sudden, they expect you to provide for yourself. All of a sudden, they expect you to behave like a grown-up. You don't know how to behave like a grown-up because you've been a child all your life. Until the time that they expect to let you go, that's when you identify that now you're a grown-up. Praise God. You know, there's never a bell that rings, maybe. Someone rings the bell, tells you, oh, now you're now a grown-up. No. You just know it by responsibility. They start coming to you. All of a sudden, maybe mom and dad have not talked to you as often as they used to. You know, you feel like maybe they're leaving me now, they don't care about me. But there's something called growing up. Praise God, it's not always a pleasant process. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And your father has a son and he wants the son to grow. Praise the Lord. It's not enough for you to be born again. Let me tell you, it's not enough just for you to come to church and just sit and listen to the word. The Lord wants you to grow. Praise the Lord. Imagine if you give birth to a child today, you give birth to your baby. And then 2 years later, that baby is still the same size that he was when he was born. Or 5 years later, that baby doesn't even know how to walk. Won't you get married? You will, right? So anything that is living is supposed to grow. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So you were born again. It's not enough for you to just stay in the born again phase, in the babyhood phase. It's not enough for you just come to sit and sit down and not do anything. That's not babyhood. That's baby stage. Your father wants you to grow. It doesn't matter where you are. It doesn't matter. You know, you may be saying that there's nothing to be done. There is so much to be done in the church. And until you start taking responsibility, you are still a baby. Because let me give you this instance. You know, when you were growing up, you know, when your mom or your dad is leaving the house, you'll be like, oh, mom, please bring me this, bring me that, bring me chocolate, bring. That's what we used to do, right? Right? But with growing up, before they leave, they start telling you what you should do while they're away. When you tell them, please bring me, they're like, I'm not bringing you that. Things change, right? So instead of you asking for things, instead of you asking your father to give you something, the father is asking you to give him something or to do something for him. That's when you know that now you've grown up. Praise the Lord. So sometimes we are comfortable, you know, in the state where we are busy asking God for things and telling God, you know, God, I want you to do this for me. And Lord, I want you to do that for me. And Lord, if you don't do it, I'll stop coming to church. And Lord, if you don't do it for me, you know what? I'm not going to pray for the next week. And Lord, if you don't do it for me, I'm going to stop giving my partnership. That's babyhood. That's the baby stage. And it feels good for us to be throwing tantrums everywhere and be like, you know, if God doesn't do it for me, then I don't know. I think you can just stop going to church because it seems like it's not working. Well, it's working because you are growing up. Because the moment you see that God is not always responding with reply or the click of your finger, then you know that you're grown up. Because if you're a baby, if you demand anything, they'll give it to you right away, right? You demand something, you know, I'm hungry, I when your brother told you to go to the kitchen and make something for yourself, right? So your mother does not jump instantly at your command and demand when you're grown up as much as she used to when you were a baby. So sometimes we are busy throwing tantrums at God. You're like, Lord, if you don't get this for me, then Lord, I don't think this church thing is helping, so I guess I can just sit at home. And if you see God not paying attention to your tantrums and your threats, you threatening God to do this and that, know that now you're grown up. Now you're grown up. The moment you're crying in a situation and you're like, God, do something. If he doesn't answer, it means he wants you to do something. Praise the Lord. It means the capability to do something about your situation is there. Praise God. So I want to let you know that sometimes when it feels like God is not showing up in your situation, when it feels like God is not doing anything about your situation, maybe he wants you to do something about it. Because maybe it's time to grow up now. Maybe it's time for you to begin to see the way your father sees things. Praise the Lord. And today I want to tell you that maturity is the point when you are ready to put your father's will before your own. Maturity is when you are ready to put your father's will before your own. To say, Lord, I may not be okay in this situation. Lord, I may not be okay with me staying in Cyprus for the sake of the gospel. Lord, I may not be okay with staying in this place. I mean, I want to go to the UK, they even get me a visa, but maybe the father said, you know what, staying here maybe for 2 more years just to preach the gospel. Then you're like, no, Lord, I can't do it. But maturity is when you're able to say, you know what, Lord, that visa or that whatever can wait, I will do what you want me to do, whatever the cost may be. Praise the Lord. That's maturity. That's the point where you begin to realize that it's your father's will that comes before your own. It takes maturity for you to do that. Praise the Lord. Because if you're a baby, you demand whatever you want, and the father will give it to you because you are a baby. So if you discover that at one point in time you're demanding things and God is not giving to you those things immediately, it simply means that it's time to grow up. Tell your neighbor, it's time to grow up. Tell your neighbor, it's time to grow up. Because your father did not birth you for you to remain in the state where you are at right now. Your father did not, God did not organize for you to be born again, just for you to sit where you are, just for you to come teach and be comfortable, just for you to come teach and do nothing, just for you to even come teach when you feel like doing it. Your father gave birth to you that you can grow. After giving birth, after birthing, the next thing is growth. Praise God. And not only growth, but growth, from growth to maturity. Praise God. Because it's not enough for you to grow. You can grow at your normal rate. You know, babies can grow normal. But your father wants you to come to maturity. Praise the Lord. You know, the Bible says, you know, let me open the scripture for you before I go to the to maturity, being led by the Spirit. Because it says that, you know, those that are led by the Spirit, that the mature sons of God, the heirs of God. We know the difference between nepios and nepios, right? Okay, who has ever heard those words? Heirs and nepios. Okay, I think just one person. Okay, so a heirs is a mature son. It's a mature son, you know, a son that has come to maturity. Praise the Lord. And then a nepios is a son. It's still a son, but it's just not yet been grown to the level that he's supposed to be at right now. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So when the Bible says that, you know, those that are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. It's meaning the heirs of God. In other words, the son that has come to maturity, that's a heirs. Praise the Lord. And that's where your father wants you to be. God is not okay by you just being in a place and coming to church every day and just doing nothing about the word of God, and you're not doing anything in the house of God, and you're not taking responsibility of any sort in his house. He wants you to come to maturity. He wants you to grow and start doing certain things in the house of God. Praise the Lord. So, you know, when I was meditating on that scripture, you know, that those that are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God, they are the heirs of God. It gave me, you know, God gave me this understanding that God does not want to work with babies. God does not want to work with babies. Praise God. He can work with you, but trust me, you'll be difficult to work with. That's why those that are led by the Spirit of God, to be led by the Spirit, it means you are being led. The Spirit is ahead of you and you're following behind him. Wherever he goes, you're going. Whatever he tells you to do, you do it. Whenever he tells you to take, you take. Whenever he tells you to stop, you stop. That's being led by the Spirit of God. Praise the Lord. That's being led by the Holy Ghost. And trust me, if you are a baby, you cannot be led by the Spirit. Why? Because you're always asking questions. Holy Spirit, where am I supposed to wait? I thought you said I should go. Holy Spirit, where are we going again? of God. That's a mature son of God. Praise the Lord. So, I told you that what I'm bringing to you may not really sound like good news to you, but it's good news. Because I want to tell you that whatever situation that you are in right now, and you feel like God is not really answering the way you want Him to, you feel like God is not really showing up the way you want Him to, you feel like, why is God not doing this thing that I want Him to do? You feel like, why is it that I haven't gotten that prayer answer that I prayed 2 months ago? Maybe God is the reason why you're there. God is the reason why you're in that phase, why you're in that season, why you're in that sin period of your life. It's for something. Praise God. Because your father, you know, let's go to Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11. I want to read in different versions so that you can just get to understand who God has called you to be and what He wants you to do. And the period where you get to say, Father, because of your will, I'll let go of my will. I want you to be able to say, because, Father, you have a plan and a purpose for me, I'll let go of whatever thing that I think I have, or whatever plan that I think I want to go to pursue, whatever, you know, plans or whatever, you know, things that I've been planning to do by myself. Praise the Lord. So maturity is the point when you come to say, it's okay for me not to have things my way right now, for God to have His way. Praise God. So maybe that season of your life is supposed to bring God glory, but maybe if you don't stay in there long enough, maybe people want to listen that that was God. So maybe God wants you to stay a bit longer in that series so that you can testify that that was God who did this for me. Because so many times men tend to take credit. You know, someone will be like, you know, okay, you know, I'm still in this situation, then all of a sudden I work hard, I make my dream, and then now I have money, so, you know, so I'm just encouraging you guys to, you know, to work hard so that you can have money. It's bringing Him glory, right? But sometimes maybe God wants you to stay in that situation so that you can be able to say at the end of the day, you know what, I was hands on, I didn't know what to do, I was ready to give up, and then God showed up. Now the glory is going to God. So sometimes we tend to fail to see the bigger picture. We forget that God has a plan for our life. We forget that, you know, even if this season of my life is not really feeling like what God said He would do in my life, it's okay, God still has a plan for me. You still believe that even if maybe I don't have the amount of money that I need right now, but because God said He has a plan for me, I'm going to believe the word of God that He has a plan for me. Even if things are not going as well as I want them to, even if my family is not maybe doing the thing that I want them to be doing for me, God still has a plan for me. Maturity is when you get to realize that the scripture does not change because of your situation. Maturity is the point when you get to realize that the scriptures don't change because of your situation. Just because maybe your feet are not looking so bright according to your physical and, you know, and your sense eyes, it does not mean that God does not have a plan. It does not mean that Jeremiah 29:11. Let's go to it. I want to read it for you guys. And I want you to know that whatever situation that you are in your life, that scripture will not change. You will not open your Bible one day and you realize, oh, there's no Jeremiah 29:11 again because you're in trouble. Whether you're in trouble, you're out of trouble, that scripture still exists. And you know, people tend to say, oh, you know, I can see that God has a plan for my life when things are good. But guess what? Even when things are not so good, God still has a plan for your life. So that scripture does not all of a sudden go away because you're in trouble. That scripture will always be there, and that scripture is true. So we need to learn to embrace whatever situation, whatever thing that you go through. And guess what? God said that He will not allow things that are bigger than you to come to you. In other words, whatever situation or problem or challenge that comes to you, it means you have a solution for it. Because if it was too big for you, then it would never come in the first place. Because God will not allow you to face the things that are bigger than you. Things that you will not conquer. Praise the Lord. So I want you to understand that the scriptures will not change because of your situation. It doesn't mean that if things are not okay today, it doesn't mean that God has forsaken you. No. He said, I'll never forsake you. Right? I'll never leave you nor forsake you, right? So that will always be the fact. Whether you feel like it or you don't, whether you feel forsaken or not, God said He'll never leave you nor forsake you. So whatever situation that you are in, whatever problem there is, still God will not leave you nor forsake you. Praise the Lord. Jeremiah 29:11. If someone is there, can you please read for me in any version? I'm going to read different versions. So. Jeremiah 29:11.
Yes. I look towards that I think towards, saith the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end.
Praise the Lord. to give you an expected end. That's what the King James Version says, right? If they even love with another version. Yes. Wait a minute. I love the message. It just makes everything way easier, right? Please let me give you the microphone. I want everyone to hear. Praise God. It says, I know what I am doing. I have it all planned out. Plans to take care of you, not to abandon you. Plans to give you the future you work for.
Praise God.
Praise the Lord. Did you hear that? God is saying, I know what I'm doing. In other words, whether you feel like God does not know what he's doing, he knows what he's doing. Praise the Lord. Would you like the Lord knows? There's nothing that happens to you that God is surprised about. There's nothing that comes to you that God will be like, oh, I can see this coming. No. He saw everything coming. In other words, your future to him is a past. He's already seen it. He's already figured out how you're going to do this. He's already figured out how you're going to meet this person, how this is going to happen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So it says, for I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. He knows. He knows. Praise God. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you a future with hope, to give you an expected end. In other words, God knows what he's doing with your life. And like what I said, you know, that scripture will not all of a sudden disappear from your mind because you are in trouble. It will not all of a sudden not mean that it is true. The word of God is true, right? So whether you're in trouble or you're out of trouble, this scripture still applies. The Father says, I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Praise the Lord. So I want you to understand that, you know, sometimes if you find yourself in a not so comfortable position, in a not so lovely, you know, environment, in a not so lovely scenario, know that God has a plan for you. Praise God. Know that your Father has a plan for me. And you as a mature son, because you know that the Father has a plan for you, what you do is you look at the bigger picture. Praise God. And when you're looking at the bigger picture, how the small pixels, you know, pictures are made of pixels, right? And they're like small, you know, elements that make up a picture. Praise God. So just because maybe that part, that pixel of the picture looks black, or maybe it's a color that you don't like, or are you supposed to be bothered? If a pixel of the bigger picture is a different color to the one that you like, are you supposed to be bothered? No, right? Why? Because it's just a pixel. It's not the whole picture, praise God. So you as a mature son, because you know that your Father has a plan for you, you tend to look at the bigger picture, not at the pixels. In other words, this season of your life, this period, this scenario that I'm not looking so lovely, remember they are all to paint a bigger picture. So it doesn't matter whether this pixel or this season of your life is not really looking as lovely as you want it to. Remember, it's all part of the bigger picture. It's all part of the bigger plan of God. It's all part of, you know, future with hope that God wants you to have. And let me tell you this, and let me declare this over your life. You remember me maybe in the next 10 years or whatever, you know, when you are not together, that you will not die. Huh? You will not die without seeing the bigger picture of God. You will not die without experiencing, without living the bigger picture. But I want you to be able to understand men and to tell the people that will be around you to say, you know, shifted things to be the way they are right now, I would have never known that God can be Jehovah Jireh. If God had not removed or maybe for some reason stopped people that maybe were financing me then or maybe providing for me then, maybe if things were still the way they were, with me having everything that I need, with me just receiving money and a phone call away, I would have never known that God can be Jehovah Jireh. I would have never known that God can provide for me. I would have never known how to depend on God. I would have never known how to be independent, how to depend on myself and to depend on God. I would have never known it if I had abundance. So sometimes the season of our life that we are crying and asking God to remove us from, they are the ones that are supposed to bring him glory. Maybe it's a season that you're supposed to get to know God better than you used to. Maybe it's another season for God to introduce to you another part of situations. Praise God. So, it, you know, I like what Pastor Diona Phillips said the other time, that sometimes you need to get to the Red Sea for you to, you know, she said you need, sometimes you will not know that God can part the Red Sea until you are there. Or you will not, maybe you will not even know the ability of God, or maybe the extent to which God can actually, you know, perform miracles unless you get to the point where you don't know what to do. Trust me, if the children of Israel would have never gotten the Red Sea, they would never know that God can part the Red Sea, right? Praise God. So the same thing is, maybe sometimes, maybe if that situation to you that is seeming like, oh, you know, this is the end of me, or oh, I'm destroyed, maybe you would have never known God, that God can save you from a certain situation if you hadn't gotten to that place, right? Even from our testimony, you know, always sharing your testimonies here, that, you know, sometimes it only took the knowledge of God, it only took you knowing what God can do for you to walk out of a certain situation. Praise God. So I want you to be able to embrace every situation that comes to you. What is just a picture to paint the bigger picture? It's just a picture. It's just a small part of the bigger plan. Praise God. So don't be bothered maybe when you're seeing a black picture. Maybe in this season of your life things are not so lovely. But remember, there's a bigger picture. And I declare upon your life that you will not die before you see the bigger picture. You will live to see the plan of God. You will live to see where God is taking you. Children of Israel, you know, they didn't really know that they were going to get your milk to a land flowing with milk and honey if they hadn't endured the wilderness. So sometimes it takes enduring the wilderness, and sometimes it takes the wilderness for you to get to know who God is. Sometimes you need to go through certain things, and let me tell you this. To God there's nothing called trouble, you know. There's nothing called, you know, oh, I'm going to bring my daughter trouble. No. To him, it's okay because he knows that all things are working together for your good. And remember, it did not say good things are working together for your good. No, all things are working together for your good. So actually, they're not so good things, they're not so pleasant things, they're not so pretty situations. They're all working together. Just for what? For good. That good is that bigger picture. That good is that plan of God that's being spoken about in Jeremiah 29:11. That I know the plan I have for you. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. So guess what? Even if you don't feel so prosperous, know that God has a plan to prosper me. So maybe this season of my life, I'm supposed to get to know and get to depend on God. Then it doesn't matter what comes my way. But God's will and God's purpose and God's plan for my life is still greater than my situation. It's still greater than how I feel right now. It's still greater than, you know, my experience or my situation or my scenario. Praise God. So you need to learn to see the bigger picture as a mature son of God. As a child of God, you need to be able to see the bigger picture. And as a son, you'll be like, you know what, Daddy? I know right now I don't feel so pleasant, or maybe I don't have that amount of money, that much amount of money that I need. But guess what? I trust you. And I love, and I know you love me enough to not leave me in this situation. Well, this is not the end. And until I win, it's not yet over. Praise God. Until you win, until you see that bigger picture, until you see the plan of God come to mind and say, well, in a way, unfold in your life, it's not yet over. So just relax. Just be sitting there and just be praying God the way you do. Just be praying the way you do. Don't let anything change because of a situation. Don't allow the devil to make you pray less because of a situation. Because guess what? That situation is working together for your good. It's all working together for your good. Praise the Lord. You know, and you know, as a mature son, one thing that I want us to know, that we need to be able to let our will down for the sake of taking up the will of God. Praise God.
Amen.
You know, we're talking, the first thing that I noted for you guys was, we need to be able to see the bigger picture. Praise God. We need to be able to understand that our Father has a plan for our life. The second one is, we need to be able to put down our will for the sake of His will. To put down your will for the sake of the will of God. In other words, just say, you know what? Things don't always have to go my way. Things don't always have to unfold the way I want them to. But let it unfold the way God wants it to. Praise God. You know, and the Lord gave me a very, you know, very profound example of a mature son, a heir of God, that came to understand that, you know what? My will is not as important as the Father's will. Let's go to the book of Matthew chapter 26. Matthew chapter 26 from verse 36. I'm just going to be picking one or two passages of scripture.
scriptures, because the whole passage, I started talking about the will of God, and I want to highlight a few verses that will make you see that a mature son is ready to put down his will for the sake of taking up the father's will. Praise God. Don't get distracted. Praise God. I want you to pay attention. I don't want you to miss this. Praise God. Matthew chapter 26, from verse 36. Matthew chapter 26. Okay, I will read from here. I'm opening the King James so you can really understand and see the picture better. Praise God. Okay, it says, then cometh Jesus with them unto a place called Gethsemane, and said unto the disciples, sit here a while, I go and pray yonder. And he took with him Peter and two sons of Zebedee, and began to be sorrowful and very heavy. Then said he unto them, my soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even unto death. Tarry ye here, watch with me. And he went a little further and fell on his face and prayed, oh Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. Praise the Lord. And I thought the King James Version was going to actually show it or paint the picture that I want you to see, but let me go to the NIV. It is simpler English. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Matthew chapter 26, verse 36. It says, then Jesus went with his disciples to the place called Gethsemane, and he said to them, sit here a while, I'll go over there and pray. He took Peter and two sons of Zebedee along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Jesus was troubled. Praise God. This was before his arrest. We all know this story, right? It was before his arrest, right? And then he said to them, my soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to a point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me. Going a little further, he fell on his face to the ground and prayed, Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken away from me, yet not as I will, but as you will. Praise the Lord. And I want you to go to, then I'm just skipping to verse 42. And he says, he went away a second time and prayed, Father, if it is possible for this cup to be taken away, unless I drink it, may your will be done. Praise the Lord. And then I'll continue to verse 43. It says, when he came back, he found they were sleeping, and because their eyes were heavy, so he left them and went away once more and prayed the third time, saying the same thing. Praise the Lord. This was Jesus praying. You know, he was faced with a very not so pleasant situation of his life. Praise the Lord. If you know, on the picture of God, on the picture of the whole master plan of God, you know, to send Jesus on earth to die for our sins, you know, that was the bigger picture, right? That was the picture that God was trying to achieve, our salvation, right? Through the death of Jesus Christ, right? But at this pixel of the bigger picture, things were not so pleasant. The Son of God had to plead to his Father that, Father, if it is possible, please, may this cup pass from me. If it's possible, Lord, this season of my life is not really looking like the way you think things would look like. This may be someone's prayer right now. You're like, God, you've seen me the vision, you've shown me the vision, I've seen the picture, I know the plan that you have for me, I know the thing that you said I would do, I know where you think you want to take me. But Lord, if it's possible, make this season of my life pass. May you quickly rush this process, this period, this phase that I'm in, because Lord, I can't take it anymore. This was the prayer of Jesus. It was like, Lord, I know I've seen the bigger picture. I know I've seen where you want to take me. I know I've seen the salvation of, you know, the billions and billions of people. I know that's what you are planning or you are intending. But if it is possible, Lord, may this cup pass from me. But it did not end there. Nevertheless, may it be your will and not mine. Praise God. In other words, as much as it was so hard for Jesus to endure that period, despite it was so difficult for him to actually stay in there and be ready to die and be separated from his father for the very first time, he was willing to do it at the expense of the will of God. In other words, he didn't want God to just let this cup pass from him according to his own will. No. He was like, Lord, may it be done according to your own will. In other words, if this is supposed to be the will of God for my life, Lord, I will take it. Doesn't matter how painful it is, doesn't matter how dark the situation may be, doesn't matter how, you know, impossible the thing may be, doesn't matter all that. But may your will be done. Praise God. So that's the prayer that the mature son makes. That, Lord, this situation or this season of my life is very difficult. But guess what? I don't want you to take it away because of my own will. I don't want you to take it away because I asked, Lord, for you to take it away from me. But I want you to take it away according to your will. And the father knows that you're a mature son. And this is just for a moment. Because right now, as we're talking, Jesus is not still on the cross. Jesus is not still in the Garden of Gethsemane trying to pray the will of God to be done. He's not there. He's sitting with the father. Praise God. And the Bible says that, you know, for the sake of the glory ahead, he endured the cross. So in other words, you know, he did not end in the dark season of his life. No. He got to the bigger picture of God. Now he's seated with the Father. In the name above every other name, the Son of God, you know, the first begotten of the Father. That's who he is now. Praise the Lord. And our Savior and our Master. But guess what? Even our mother had to go through that dark, not so pleasant situation. Praise God. But he took a mature son to be able to say, you know what? I will let your will be done in my life. Doesn't matter how your will is against my own will. Doesn't matter how I want things to go this way. But Father, if you want things to go that way, then I will follow you. It doesn't matter maybe your plans seem to be against my own plans. A mature son will put down his will to take up the will of the Father. That's a mature son. You need to be able to say, you know what, Lord, it doesn't matter how dark the situation may be. Lord, you know, sometimes it's okay to be honest with your father. He's like, Lord, I don't know how I'm going to come out of this. I don't know. Honestly, I don't. Lord, I don't have all the answers. Lord, I really maybe need that money. I don't know where I'm going to get it from. But because I know you know the plans you have for me. Because I know that you know the plans that you have for me. In other words, I know that you know what you're doing. So because I know and I trust that you know what you're doing, Lord, I will let you go. And I'll walk through this season of my life with joy. And I'll come to church and I'll praise you like I never would.